So you can see that building a simple auto cycle simulator is fairly straightforward. We've done that. The next type of problem is basically math problems. Well, what are we trying to solve here? Well, I'm basically solving a simple elliptic partial differential equation. So the PDE that I'm going to solve, dou square u by dou x square equal to zero. I apologize for the bad handwriting. My pen is giving me some problems. So can anyone tell me what's the analytical solution for this PDE? If I solve this PDE, what is the answer that I'll get? It's a straight line, correct? So it's a straight line. And to solve it, what we are going to be using is, we're going to be using a numerical technique. So I'm going to be using Taylor series and I'm going to discretize this guy. And I'm not going to go into the details, but the way you, if you discretize it, you will basically get u of x plus delta x plus u of x minus delta x divided by 2. So that would be the way to do it using numerical analysis. So this is the PDE that I'm trying to solve. All right. So what I'm doing is I'm using basic numerical discretization. If you don't know numerical discretization, it comes from Taylor series, right? So if you discretize this, you'll get it, you'll basically get u of x plus delta x minus 2 times u of x plus u of x minus delta x divided by delta x square. All right, so this is going to be equal to 0. So if I solve this for u of x, then I will basically get u of x plus delta x plus u of x minus delta x divided by 2. All right, so in other words, if you're using array indexing, again, since I cannot teach you like complete MATLAB in one day, I'll just call this as u of I plus 1 plus u of I minus 1 divided by 2. This is going to be the update. This is going to be the update rule. And if I do this multiple times, does anyone know what type of an iterative solver I'm using? So this right here is basically your Jacobi iteration. Right, Jacobi, Gauss-Seidel, SOR, you know, you might have heard of terms like that. The reason why you need to understand or basically learn these type of things is because that is what is being used in the industry now. A core mechanical engineering, it's not enough if you know, if you just know, for example, things like, okay, these are the density values, density ranges for this particular metal. This is the melting point. And if you just know things like, okay, I know the formula for Hagen's pressure drop equation. Just knowing these things is no longer going to be enough. Especially if you want to get into a core company job, these type of questions are what is being asked today. Nowadays, mechanical engineers are being asked to code a lot. So for example, at an undergraduate level, if you're going for a shop floor engineer or a maintenance engineer, you don't have to know anything. Then your starting salary is at the range of 10 to 15,000. And most of them will get replaced by automation in the future. But coding engineers is what you require. A typical engineer who can code very well, who understand numerical analysis, you can expect a starting salary of 6 to 7 lakhs. And I'm talking about starting like right after BE. But you need to basically be able to understand whatever I'm saying right now quite easily. And the sad part is all of these things are covered in your first 3 semesters of mathematics. Right? But I know that when people tell you about this, they don't tell you the background or application, which makes it very hard to learn these advanced topics. But it's never too late. Still try to focus on learning these type of concepts. You still have time, okay? All right, so I have this basic update rule. So if we go here, let us write a computer program for it. I'm first creating a 20 grid point system. This is a computational mesh. I'm creating a single, a one-dimensional computational mesh using the linspace command. I'm putting my boundary conditions. So for example, if everyone recalls Megan Patel's answer, it's Cx plus K. So there are two constants because you're integrating two times, which means you need two boundary conditions to evaluate the expression correctly. So you're giving a boundary condition of the first node and the last node. And then I'm starting my iterative solver. And there you go. This is the update rule, right? I had u of I plus 1 plus u of I minus 1 by 2. Instead of I, I'm using a J index. That's the only difference. Now, this is an iterative method, meaning it will start with a random value, but then over time, it will converge to the right answer. So for example, if I run the code, you can see that it starts with random values, but then as iteration progresses, it reaches a steady value and no longer changes.